In high school, I was very popular. I was a class president my junior year. I was a senior class president as well. I was a captain of the track team, captain of the football team. I was on the homecoming court. I was the prom prince when I was a junior. I was on the prom court when I was a senior. So I was very popular. And it seemed to me, as long as I was very good athletically, I was outgoing, all those things would fall in the road for me. From age 0 to 17, my life was, from the outside, looked like a fairy tale. Everything I touched turned to gold. Life was wonderful. And I was very athletic, and I was doing very well on the football team and was getting a lot of scholarship offers as the season progressed. And midway through the season, I blew out my knee, tore off 3 ligaments, and that was the end of my football career. I went to college. I went to Case Western. I was like the class president. I started doing the same things in college I did in high school, positions of leadership, positions of visibility on campus. If I found somebody who was a Christian, I would attack them. Well, as the year progressed, my older brother, who was at Teal College for his undergrad career, graduated, went to Temple Law School, he calls me and says that he has a problem. Could I come talk to him? Which I did. He and his friend, Roger Pratt, had burglarized some fraternity houses while they were on campus. They got together. They had a fight. My brother, who was a very large man, beat Butch up and killed him right on the spot. I helped my brother flee the scene. I helped him cover up the crime. I was questioned by the police multiple times. I lied to the police multiple times. To say it was a horrifying experience would be an understatement. I mean, there's absolutely not words to describe what it's like to see your brother do something of that magnitude and then carry it around, because I didn't tell anybody about what I had seen. So, well, I'm talking to somebody, or I'd be at work talking about whatever product line I was working on at the time, but it was always on my mind. I'm carrying this burden around, and nobody knew it. And it was eating me up inside. I was engaged in May. We bought a home, and we would be married December 30th, 1989. I was arrested 2 months before our wedding day. The night I was arrested, Susan, my fiance, was sitting home addressing our invitations to the wedding. So that was the last time I saw her in freedom, was running out of our house as the police were stuffing me in the back of a police car and a policeman throwing his arm around her to restrain her from getting to me. That was my last image of her. I was arrested for complicity to aggravated murder with death specifications as my brother's accomplice. And that was the first night I prayed in probably 4 years. And I prayed that God would just let me die. I prayed, if you exist, I don't want to go through what I know is going to happen, let me die. Because that's all I could do. I couldn't undo what I did. I couldn't make my crime go away. And it was crazy, because in a way it was almost liberating to have that secret exposed to the light, because it was a horrifying thing to be living with. So I went to court, and the judge says, guilty. And that started giving me consecutive sentences for the various parts of my indictment. I couldn't even add the numbers in my head. And I determined that before I walked in the first cell with my first roommate of my prison experience, I was not going to show any fear. Because they say if you show fear, it's sort of like a shark. They can sense it, then they'll attack you. So I had my mean face on as I went to the cell. I was trying to look as confident as I could. And they opened the cell door up, and I looked inside there. And the guy was wearing a pair of jeans and a flannel shirt because he was too big to fit in any jumpsuit they had. And he had a scar that started at the back of his head, and it ran across his forehead, across his eye, and his eye was hanging out on his cheek. He had a black beard down to his stomach, and his head was shaved just like mine was. And I looked at that guy, and I thought, there's no way I'm going in that cell. But the guard told me to go in there, and I went in there. I put my locker box down, and I shot him my mean face, and I jumped up on the bed, and I didn't move, because I didn't want to disturb him. I thought, if I shake this face, he's going to kill me. Then I figured, he is going to kill me, and he will probably eat me. Then they'll think I escaped. And they announced they were going to have a Protestant service at chapel in Summit County, and they were going to pass out candy bars. So I thought I would go to the chapel service, I would act like I was sick, get the candy bar, and I would leave. So I go up to the service, they lock the door behind us, and they announced they're going to pass out the candy bars at the end of the service. Now I was mad, because they tricked me. And the more he talked about what a sinner we were and that we're going to hell apart from Christ, the more mad I became. And the more he preached the gospel straight from the hip, the more I wanted to get up and make a fool out of him. So I determined that next week I would study my Bible, I'd come back and make a fool of him and discredit him in front of the eyes of these guys. So I started reading in Matthew because I couldn't find the woman at the well in the index. By the time I got to John chapter 4 with the woman at the well, God had crushed me. And not only was the hillbilly right, that I was a sinner and going to hell, but I deserved to go there. It wasn't that I was going to hell because of my brother's sins that I was covering up. They were my sins. So the next week, I went back to that service, and the same preacher was there, and he preached a different style. He was talking like about God's grace, and he said, and this was what struck me the hardest, he said, some of you guys probably shouldn't even be here. But he said, if you're sitting in an orange jumpsuit in a county jail, your life is a mess. And apart from Christ, you cannot get your life right. And he was speaking right to me. But now he had the solution for me, which was the grace, because Jesus Christ died on the cross for my sins. And that night, all alone in my cell, it was cell 42, range 5, right next to the shower there, I got down on my knees, and I asked Christ to come into my life. And at the time, I was still facing the death penalty. But I just had a sense of peace about God was in control, and everything's going to be all right.